Our pastor, Reverend John Scott, to the podium to deliver this morning's message. Reverend John is my brother in truth and our pastor here at the Temple of Light Center for Spiritual Living. Welcome, Reverend John.
I love to be called a brother in truth. Thank you, Sonia Maureen, radiant sister of my soul. And good morning, family of my very life and being, family of light, family of love, family of joy. Just so wonderful to stand before you and to feel the energy that last hymn, first hymn, just so vibrant and full of energy and of love. I see somebody in the audience that look exactly like Carl Livingstone. They must be related. Welcome. And there was Maestro Watson walking elegantly on a pair of crutches. I think it's a fashion statement. Welcome, Maestro. Welcome all. You know, when I was on vacation all of August, I told you I did a lot of spiritual work. And one of the things I explored was how I could reach for a higher faith. And so I've titled my talk this morning, Reaching for a Higher Faith. Anybody there with me wanting to deepen their belief, just strengthen their walk with spirit and reach for a higher faith? Can I hear an amen?
Amen. Yeah.
And so, you know, I found these words by a little kid called Edward J. McGrath Jr. in Chicken Soup for the Soul. Listen to this. I'm not old enough to play baseball or football. I'm not 8 yet. My mom told me, when you start baseball, you aren't going to be able to run that fast because you had an operation. I told mom, I wouldn't have to run that fast when I play baseball. I'll just hit them out of the park and then I'll be able to walk. Friends, for millennia, people have been pondering this subject of faith. So if you're thinking about it, you have joined the sages and saints of the ages who have described it in multiple ways, but it remains shrouded in a mystery that defies definition, really. What is it? You know, I'm always touched by the fact that Jesus never said, I have healed you. He always said, go thy way. Why? Thy faith has made thee whole. And I want that wholeness. I want to feel that sense of belonging and togetherness with the presence and power. Each of us knows when we don't have it, when that faith is absent, and how overwhelming the absence can be. Lack of faith can bring a paralyzing fear that determines not only our present actions, but also the future actions that we take, the future upon which we embark. It's not a faculty with which some are blessed copiously and others have little or none. Faith is natural and innate in all humans. If, as I just mentioned, the little boy, if you observe children exploring their environment, you can surmise that there's a natural faith involved in their exploration. Their naivety and curiosity support a trust that involves hope and expectation. And as you know, trust, hope, and expectation are essential byproducts of faith. So faith is an integral part of our growing up. And this natural faith, to a large degree, is responsible for our maturation. Though we are born with all the faith we need to deal with life, it can be either lost or enhanced, depending on the results of our early explorations. If the parents and adults who mentored us were centered in faith, then the results of our explorations of the world became powerful building blocks for our own faith. However, and this is too often the case, if our support persons were driven by fear, our capacity to grow our faith was handicapped. In more extreme cases, when our childhood entailed abuse or neglect, we could emerge into adulthood with little or no of this faculty known as faith. The good news is that we can return to our natural faith. If an awareness of the status of your faith and finding techniques to restore it are an essential component of your own spiritual quest today, you have come to the right place at the right time this morning, because I'm here to tell you that you can actually heal those childhood experiences that initially eroded your faith. And you can come to a place of greater hope and inspiration in all that you do or plan to be. And so this morning, as I told you, my talk is entitled Reaching for a Higher Faith. You know, friends, you can reconstitute your faith by simply acknowledging the principle of God's omnipresence. If you are willing to abide by and practice this omnipresence, you will not only restore your natural faith, but you will enhance it. It's not always easy, but the process really is very simple. You see, friends, by acknowledging God's existence in and as us, we are automatically immersed in God's power and wisdom. Let us affirm together, I live in God's omnipresence and think with God's omniscience. Together, I live in God's omnipresence and think with God's omniscience. The still waters of God's omnipresence and omniscience run deeply through my soul. The still waters of God's omnipresence and omniscience run deeply through my soul. So this week, practice claiming this power and wisdom as the basis of everything you think, say, and do. And you will be amazed at how powerfully you engender a creative response from the indwelling God of your very being. Dr. Holmes, who gave the world this great teaching, asserted that this corresponding action works persistently like a law. This is the basic axiom of the creative urge of God working through us. You think, easier said than done, Reverend John. Perhaps, my friends, the agonized cry of the father of the epileptic boy in Mark 9:24, and I quote, Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief, unquote. Perhaps that agonized cry echoes the challenge which you face when it comes to reaching for a higher faith. You see, many of us believe in the power of belief, but find it difficult to ourselves believe. We believe in the power of belief, but we find it difficult to rev up that belief in our own consciousness, in our own system. We pray and we want to have the faith that gives us the certain assurance that our prayer has impressed itself in the creative law of mind and will be answered. But just in case, I better ask somebody whose prayers I believe are stronger than mine. Notice I said that you believe in the strength of the other person's prayers. A lot of people say to me, Reverend John, your prayers are very powerful. Do a treatment for me. They also asked three other practitioners just in case I wasn't at full speed, you know. You believe, and that belief sometimes is misplaced. Instead of believing in your own power and your own divinity and your own omniscience and the omnipresence within you, you believe it is more powerfully somewhere else. The beautiful Jesus himself gave the answer when he said, quote, when you pray, believe you receive and you shall receive, unquote. Interestingly, the Greek word for receive is in the past tense. So it should actually be translated as believe you received. In other words, your faith is so strong that you know beyond the shadow of a doubt that the spiritual creation has already taken place on the unseen side of life, and now it is only a matter of its appearance in form on this plane of experience, because it's already a divine done deal. The gift has already been given. All of us know people who seem to possess this faith. They seem to have an unquestioning assurance that what they request will be granted. In fact, I am willing to bet that all of us at one time or another have had such an experience, yes? When you have just known and it has happened. But then, you know, Jacob wrestled with the angel until the angel granted his demand. But perhaps such moments of complete faith have been too far and it's been too much time, far and few. And something in you cries out, how can I reach for a higher faith so that I believe every time? How can I reach for a higher faith so that I believe all the time, not just sometimes? Walter Stark, author of a book titled It's All God, which we are studying in my Thursday morning classes, to which you're invited, contends that faith is not what someone has. You don't have faith. Faith is what someone does. It's not what you have, it's what you do. Faith for Stark is not a noun, it's a verb. He says that faith has to be an act of conviction to be legitimately called faith. And I quote, thinking is static, but faith is active. Those who believe they have faith but do not do the things they have faith in fail because there is no such thing as having faith in anything. Things are results. Things are effects. Having faith in something, even in a religion, is putting faith in results rather than in cause. And what is cause? God. Unless we do God, we have no faith in God. End of that quote from Stark. As students of science of mind, we have all been exposed to this teaching that our thoughts and our faith create things. I think everybody here understands that and believes that. We actually create our experiences by having faith and then living from that faith. We all have faith, but many of us have faith in harmful or inharmonious things as well as in beneficial ones. I know some people who have great faith in lack and even in illness. They actually create what they have actively been envisioning for many years. A friend of mine told me some years ago that all the women in her family had succumbed to cancer, and she was just waiting for her doctor to confirm her diagnosis. She didn't yet have cancer, but she was actively doing the mental work, which would ensure that one day she eventually would. Fortunately, I was able to get her to stop doing sickness and to begin doing health. She had told me that her greatest desire was to really know God. So in my usually reverent manner, I told her that there was no need for her to go visit him on the non-physical plane of existence, since she could know him in the context of perfect health, well-being, and happiness right here, so, right here on this plane of activity. But you may ask, is it really possible to know God? Rocco Errico, the Aramaic scholar and author, writes, and I quote, to know God means more than just an intellectual definition that satisfies a curious mind. Knowing God has nothing to do with being familiar with a concept of God. Concepts, ideas, and definitions are helpful, but are not ends in themselves. They only point to a reality. They are never the reality they may be describing. We need definitions to help us communicate with one another, but the real meaning of knowing is beyond words and symbols. It takes a genuine, living realization in our hearts, souls, and bodies to know God or divine mind. End of that quote. Errico explains that for Near Easterners, knowing is not just a mental activity, it is also experiential. For them, knowing has an emotional presence in the entire body, not just in the mind. This is why, for example, the author of Genesis writes, and I quote, so Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain, unquote. Knowing here refers to physical intimacy. To the Near Easterner, then, knowing is a total and comprehensive experience. In this context, knowing God means realizing divine mind as a vital energy that nourishes our spirit, soul, and body. End of the Errico quote. The psalmist tells us, be still and know that I am God. Note he did not say, become still and believe that I am God. The emphasis was on knowing, And I'm not surprised, since you will agree, it is easier to believe in someone after we have come to know them, don't? Many of us would find it hard to trust someone we didn't know, but confidence in them grows when we come to know them. The lesson here is that we must learn to quiet our minds and bodies so that we can begin to sense and know the divine presence within. And as we do, we begin to achieve a higher faith and to experience the deep inner joy, peace, and freedom that come from knowing that you live in the omnipresence and think with the omniscience of Almighty God. Writer Paul R. Van Gorder tells the story of a passenger ship caught in a violent storm while sailing from England to New York. The ship tossed so violently that it awakened everyone on board, including the captain's 8-year-old daughter. "What's the matter?" the frightened child cried. After her mother explained about the storm, she asked, "Is father on deck?" Assured that he was, the little girl snuggled back into bed with her teddy bear and in a few moments was sound asleep. Although the winds still blew and the waves still rolled, she had peace because her father was at the helm. This morning, friends, no matter how stormy the outer conditions of your world may appear to be, I want you to reach for a higher faith by knowing that that same presence and power which Jesus called Father, that enabled him to walk on water, that same presence and power empowers you to walk across the troubled waters of human experience and say to the storms of your life, "Peace, be still." And you can be assured that when you do, it will be done as you believe, because your Father, that presence and power within you, is at the helm on your life's journey. Let us affirm together, God is my pilot, faith is my beacon light, I am anchored in peace. Together, God is my pilot, faith is my beacon light, and I am anchored in peace. To your neighbor, say, God is your pilot, faith is your beacon light, you are anchored in peace. God is your pilot, faith is your beacon light, and you are anchored in peace. God is your pilot, faith is your beacon light, you are anchored in peace. Just stop for a moment and take a deep breath and let that saturate your consciousness. As they say, pre that word there. God is my pilot. Faith is my beacon light. I am anchored. I am secure. I am safe. I am held by the hands, the everlasting arms. I am at peace. Let the immensity of that idea dawn upon you in your consciousness and take it with you all this week. For when you truly believe that the presence and power within you is your pilot on life's journey, when you understand that your Father is at the helm, you will never have to ask what to do to get faith. All you will have to do is keep your awareness on this indwelling presence. Keep it alive in you. Live it, know it, experience it at your deepest level. Which brings me to your assignment. Your assignment, should you decide to undertake it, is to consciously practice the presence of God this week. And I'm going to tell you how to practice the presence of God. Look for it everywhere. And maybe one of the things you can do is turn off your phone for a few moments every day so that you can be in touch with the presence and power that knows no obstacles. Look for God everywhere. realize God, recognize God, celebrate God. The older theologies separated things into physical world versus the spiritual world. I want you to break down this partition in your thinking and learn to see God in everything. Your assignment then is to be specially mindful of the presence everywhere all this week. See the presence in the blushing cheek of a ripening fruit. Taste the presence in its sweetness. Hear the presence in the chirping of birds and the laughter of children at play. Praise the presence in a lizard catching flies on your wall. Instead of going for the bagon, say, "Hello, God. Thank you. Thank you for expressing in this wonderful way." Feel the presence in the strains of your favorite music. And above all, honor the presence in every single person you encounter. Even folks with whom you may disagree, or people who appear unloving or unlovely to you. Remind yourself this week that the intelligence they use is the one intelligence, even though they may not be using it for what you consider to be the good of all. Dr. Ernest Holmes, the founder of our teaching, said, and I quote, "A realization of the presence of God is the secret power of our work." The realization of the presence of God is the secret power of our work. Just remember that as you walk out of this sanctuary this morning, you walk as the emissary, the ambassador, the living embodiment of the Creator of all things. Wow! When you think, it is God thinking. When you speak, it is God speaking. When you act, it is God reaching out to touch other human beings. Think about the responsibility that you have, that has been bestowed upon you, the gift that has been given you to represent the living Spirit Almighty in every facet and relationship of your life and your experience. The psalmist gave expression to this mystical sense of the inescapable presence when he asks in Psalm 139, which is one of my favorite, "Whither shall I go from thy spirit? Or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be light about me. Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee." The darkness and the light, the yin and the yang of existence, are both alike to the Creator of all, that is in all, through all, over all in all, and therefore at the center and the circumference of your life. So let that presence, my friends, rekindle the fires of faith within you as you reach for a higher faith in the certain assurance that God is your pilot, faith is your beacon light, and you are indeed anchored in peace. Go your way, your faith has made you whole. Namaste.